Hello, thank you so much for coming this evening. My name is Nicola Gunn, and I'm one of the artists in residence here at Pier 23 in this Kaldor Art Project. And I have invited an interlocutor tonight who I will probably defer to throughout this conversation as an expert in the field that I would like to talk about. So it's probably me interviewing Hayley more than anything. And this is Hayley Fuller, and I found her through the Centre for Peace and Conflict Studies here in Sydney. And maybe you can say something about yourself.
Well, I guess, as Nicola just said, I recently completed my Master of Peace and Conflict Studies, which can range a huge, broad area of and ideas about peace and conflict and things like that. But what I focused on for my dissertation was the way that performance art can contribute to peace building or cultural peace building and conflict transformation. So that's how I'm here with Nicola.
Because that's what I'm going to do. That's right. Change the world. Make peace. I should just say as well that I want you to feel free to intervene or interject at any point to create maybe a more informal conversation or possibly redirect the conversation to whatever you're interested in. We can do that as well. Or we can just talk about my work. Okay. Sounds like we're talking about my work. So I am developing a work at the moment called Peace for Person and Ghetto Blaster. And the reason why I chose this film, it's not actually a film I've ever seen before. So this is the first time I've ever seen it. But when I described my projects to a director and theatre maker, and I described a little bit about what it was about, the area that I was exploring, and perhaps the genesis of the project, which I will also tell to you, he said, he kind of looked off in the distance and said, I remember this documentary I watched late at night. It was this French documentary. And he described this documentary to me, and I thought I had to see it. Because what I loved about watching this documentary is seeing children, whatever interests them, they just do it. And it's I find that so fascinating. This kind of personal liberation they have. And also the fact that conflict and friction, it seems to be a fundamental part of their social relations. And I found that also very fascinating. And I'm very interested in the way we behave and I suppose social conventions and things like that. I'll probably describe what happened to me, why I came to be making this work, why I'm interested in peace and conflict transformation, and probably how I came to this documentary. I'm not a very nice person. It's probably the beginning. But something happened to me early last year. I was in Ghent in Belgium, and I had just come back from a run along the canal. And what I love about Ghent is that you run for 5 minutes and you're in the countryside and you're running past windmills and farms, and it's incredibly idyllic and it's so rural and quiet. And I was coming back from my run into the main part of Ghent where I was staying, and I was at this area by the canal that there was a little railing, and I was stretching. And as I was stretching, I was just watching this man, and he was quite listless. He looked a little bit rumpled, you know, and he was throwing stones into the canal. And And I thought, oh, this is like a very sad image of a man who, and I, you know, my imagination was jumping to conclusions. Why is he throwing stones in the canal in the middle of the day? I thought he was like skimming, but he wasn't. He was throwing. And then I realized he was aiming at something. And I thought he was throwing stones at this plastic bag or something, some kind of debris or rubbish that had been caught in the branches of some of these low-hanging trees. And I looked a little bit closer and I realized that he was throwing stones at a sitting duck. And the duck was sitting on a nest. And that the expression, a sitting duck, I guess comes about because a duck, when it's sitting, when it's brooding, incubating eggs, it will not move because it's imperative that the eggs are a very specific temperature. And this temperature has to be maintained for the incubation period. And this man was systematically just throwing stones, aiming at this duck. And what I then also... before that, I also noticed that he was ignoring his two young children as he was throwing stones at the duck. And he kind of seemed very distant and detached, and I thought that was another... That was part of my sad image of this sad, rumpled man. Before I noticed that he was throwing stones at a duck. But when I looked again, I realized that his children, and they were probably about the same age as the children, two little girls, about the age of the girl in the last vignette with the curly hair who was too scared to jump off the ledge. They were looking around the area to pick up stones to give to him to throw at the duck. And this all happened very quickly, this kind of processing of information. And I suppose like the cliche would be like something inside me snapped and I was moving before I even knew that I was moving once I'd realized what I was seeing, once I'd processed it. And I went over to him, I kind of launched towards him and I said, "Excuse me, what do you think you're doing? What you're doing is unnecessary." And I was really stern and really firm with him. And he sort of ignored me, and that fired me up even more. And I spoke to him again. I reprimanded him, I suppose. And I kept repeating that what he was doing was unnecessary. That's unnecessary. That's unnecessary. And then he started sort of yelling at me to say, "Piss off." I suppose the thing is, we had a language barrier. I didn't speak his language and he didn't speak my language. So I started yelling at him in English, which was completely futile. And then he started yelling at me in whatever his language was. And we were just yelling at each other. And I was trying to get him to stop throwing stones at the duck. And then he kept throwing stones and he hit the duck on the head. And then that escalated the situation once again. And I went into full-blown, like, psycho woman mode. And I was screaming at him to stop doing what he was doing. And then I started yelling at his kids because I was kind of trying to think of how can I hurt this man, you know? Like, how can I inflict violence on this man? And then I crossed a line. Like, I seriously crossed a line. But what I was yelling at his kids was, "Your father is a fucking idiot. I pity you. He's a Neanderthal." And of course, you know, they didn't know what I was saying, and they kind of were just staring at me, like really curious. They were so unaffected by the whole situation. They'll probably be in therapy later. But and so when I started yelling at his children, he got very angry. And that fired him up. And then he started coming towards me and sort of physically gesturing that he was like trying to grab my crutch, like it maybe a cultural insult. But he was kind of, I guess approaching me in quite a confronting way and just like coming at my crutch. And I kind of went, "Whoa. What are you trying to do? Hurt my feelings? Grab my vagina? Whoa!" But I did freak out a bit because I thought, well, this is a very uncomfortable situation because the children were there and I couldn't understand why this was actually unfolding in front of the children, and passerbyers just kept passing by, and nobody stopped or intervened, and I started crying because I realized that I couldn't change the situation, and I had to walk away. And then when I got home, I Facebooked about it. I needed some kind of comfort to reach out. And then I got all these Facebook posts, you know, are you all right, Nicola? Are you okay? Oh, that's horrible. And it's kind of exactly what I needed. But as I was walking away from him crying, I was also fantasizing about the acts of retribution I would commit. I would perhaps come back later and hide and find him and then follow him home and find out where he lived. And like, usually I do this a lot, that I fantasize of these violent acts. And it's, they're really like low crime. Like it's about like throwing bricks in people's windows and stuff. And you know, and I really plan it out in my head. Like, I wear gloves, and sometimes I catch myself practicing walking like a guy, because I know that when I do that, when I throw the brick through the window, I'd be in disguise. I'd have a hoodie, but I'd be like pretending I was a man, so no one, like the cameras. So I do this a lot, and I play out these fantasies of retribution, and I do it with my real estate agent a lot. Like, I imagine keying her car, and it's so real, but I never actually act on them. And I asked somebody else, a friend of mine, when I was telling a story, you know, if they also had violent fantasies of revenge or retribution, and he said no. And I was like, no, but everyone does, don't they? He's like, no, I've never had this kind of thought, Nicola. I was like, really? And I started thinking, worrying about this. Why am I so attracted to violence? And because the fact is, I quite enjoyed this altercation with this man. I quite enjoy finding myself in situations of conflict. I perhaps am a very fractious person. I don't know, but. And I think we were talking about it a bit before, and it's like, do I want to hurt people's feelings, or do I just want to disrupt the status quo? And I think it's the latter. But I do also have a propensity of hurting people's feelings. But I don't mean to. So that's my story. And that's why I'm interested in conflict, resolution, conflict transformation, peace and conflict. Because I'm wondering how I could have resolved this conflict with this man better. How can I communicate better? How can I become a better person? So that's why I've invited Hayley here. And I don't know, what should we kick off? We're kind of workshopping my show, I guess, a little bit.
Or doing a therapy session, I'm not sure.
Or doing therapy, maybe. Oh, people are leaving already. Yes?
I'm just wondering, would it have been possible to go in front of the duck as another alternative way of dealing with the situation? Would it have been possible, or was it cold and you couldn't get the water to get in front? To stop the duck?
Yeah. No, absolutely. That would have been an alternative. It didn't occur to me. I just wanted him to stop what he was doing, because I thought that it was wrong, and I passed, I guess, a moral judgment on what is right and wrong, and that's kind of what I'm interested in now. But no, it didn't. It was cold and dirty. Yeah.
So you weren't very committed to the cause?
No, I don't know. Maybe I actually just wanted to get into a fight with him more than I wanted to save the duck. I don't know.
I'm not sure that the outcome would have necessarily been different had you have tried to. Often we think sometimes that resolving something through one means rather than another might somehow be better or more ethical, but often the outcomes are ultimately the same. So sometimes when we're thinking about the ways that we're going to resolve a conflict, we really need to think a little bit beyond just stopping it right now, or and think about longer term, what are all of your possible outcomes going to be, and whether standing in front might have stopped the duck from being hit for a moment, but you might have been similarly, he would have approached you, I assume, in the same sort of a manner. And, you know, there's all sorts of strange sorts of questions we need to ask about how we're going to resolve a conflict and what all of our outcomes might be. And if the outcome is the same, why is one means better than another?
You must have had a cell phone with you or a camera. You didn't think of photographing him?
No, I'd just been running, so I didn't have anything.
Okay.
No. But I did go home and Google. I mean, it is against the law in Belgium to harm ducks. Yeah. So, but I did check back every consecutive day that I was there and the duck was still there. So... I was sort of holding vigil for as long as I could, but then I had to go.
Just maybe that's where you're going, but so we can start talking about your performance. Can you tell us what you plan on doing, or is the plan for us to help you plan it?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
So, I mean, I have a person, I have a ghetto blaster, I don't have a piece, is the problem at the moment. I've had a couple of thoughts. When you kind of overthink, all my ideas are dumb, they're dumb now, I hate them all. So I'm having a little bit of a crisis with what I'm going to do with this. And I don't know whether I'm making a show about this or whether this is just the genesis of... the show, but I guess I had I was interested in creating conflict with the audience, just so I could attempt to resolve it. And I asked Hayley, how can I create conflict with the audience? And she kind of we didn't know,
but after watching,
it's too constructed. You know, why would I want to do? I don't know. I'm questioning whether that's what I want to do.
I think I was thinking about that discussion that we'd had earlier about how to create conflict, and then watching the kids, I thought, they're just creating conflict out of absolute thin air all the time, and they managed to do it and resolve it. And I think one of the things that made me reflect upon is the way that conflict and the way that we experience it, the way it evolves, is all... It's often not about real things. It's about... meanings and symbolisms that we attach to things, and that affects the way that we experience things, and it affects the way, you know, whether or not something turns into a conflict, and it affects how badly or personally we take that conflict. And I think that's one of the things I really noticed within those kids. So, that's maybe just a continuation of our discussion of how do you possibly create conflict, but about, you know, the way that it's really just about the kind of meanings we ascribe to nothing or something.
And I guess the other idea was maybe having some kind of conflict resolution workshop or something like that, and maybe assigning the audience a role, either of the man or the duck or something like that. So I'm still in the very early stages. I don't know. Very confused.
Maybe talk a little bit about your masters and so it's looking at conflict and resolution in performance art practice?
Well, it's a Master of Peace and Conflict Studies, so I undertook a number of different coursework units on different areas of conflict. I tended to specialise in each of those out of my own interest on ideas about language, and I guess the way, you know, things like morality I looked at a lot, and, you know, our system of knowledge and how we learn, how we should behave and things like that. And I definitely have more of an interest in community and personal conflict rather than, international conflict and wars and things, because my understanding of peace is, you know, a little bit different to just ceasing war. It's about something else. But my dissertation, so my biggest research project that spanned the 2 years of the master's, I basically looked at analysing the process of creating art. I used a specific case study of performance art, so I did kind of narrow down on that. But my idea was generally to talk about the creative process of, you know, working on art and artistic expression, and how we could figure out. I basically parted from the idea that I believe that art does contribute to peace building or you know, conflict resolution in a way, and it can. Not necessarily all art does, but it can. And I wanted to understand why that might be. So I'm ultimately a theorist who tried to use post-structural theory and some performative theory, a bit of narrative therapy ideas and things, to pick apart what goes on inside our brains when we're creating art, and why that might let us, you know, get us to a better resolution for a conflict. I used a few kind of. I had my case study, which was Super Barrio Gomez, a Mexican performance artist from the 1980s. And actually, Nicola and I are debating whether he's a performance artist or not. But did you want to say something?
No, it's just. I mean, it's contentious. I don't think he set out to be an artist or a performance artist, an activist who became a performance artist or something by. I think other people assigning him the role of performance artist, perhaps.
Yeah, I think ultimately he started out as, you know, a collective group of activists who were trying to express themselves in different ways and not just walk around with, you know, a bunch of posters. And they started doing, you know, creative things and different, looking for different ways to express their protest. And ultimately what they ended up doing was some really beautiful performance art without even realising that that's where they ended up. So, yeah, not necessarily I want to do a performance piece now, but what they ended up doing, I think, and it's my personal opinion, that it followed all of the kind of ideas of what I would expect from that. So that's the case study I used. I used a few different kinds of different pieces of art, poetry and things throughout to make some other references, but that's my key case study.
Just as an option for the ducks, my father taught me not to bite by biting me, to show me that it's painful and that it hurts. So it's an option that can either resolve the conflict, because I very much learned that that wasn't okay after that. But, for example, if you had started throwing stones at the man or at his children, it can either make him realise that perhaps that's wrong, or it can just further escalate the conflict
and actually
have him throw back harder.
I didn't think about getting in the water, but I did think about throwing stones at the man. And I actually couldn't find any big enough stones. I quickly cast. It was a very heated moment. But yeah, it's a good suggestion. I wanted to talk to you more about this idea of peace, and if we're. What I like about this notion of conflict transformation, and maybe you can talk more about what conflict transformation is that it's saying that, or perhaps it's suggesting that conflict is like a fundamental part of democracy, and that conflict can be used constructively or to be turned into something constructive and useful. Is that kind of...
Yeah, although I wouldn't use the word democracy.
Okay.
I would just say it's kind of part of human nature that conflict will arise. I mean, it is definitely part of democracy as well, but I'd go a little step larger and say, you know, in whatever regime you are in, that we will have conflicts. But I think the second part that I tack onto that is that conflict is kind of inevitable and natural, but violence isn't and doesn't have to be. Because I think it's a really scary, scary sort of world that we start looking at if we say that violence is natural and normal. And that's nothing I ever want to be involved in. Although Nicola and I had a kind of interesting idea about whether it might or might not be natural or irrational and what have you. So you can debate it.
Yeah, I just wondered if violence was irrational. And that people that don't resort to violence, it's because they live in a realm of rationality or something, which is why I just fantasize, but I don't actually ever enact, because I think I am a rational person, and I know that there are consequences if I actually did commit some kind of violence against another human being or animal. But
I was thinking, as we were watching the film, the little boy, Alexandre, who was collecting the sticks on his own at the start, and a girl approached him, and she was being really friendly to him. And he was being pretty mean at the start. And then later on, another little boy came to try and build a house with him, and he was pretty mean to him as well before it kind of took a while to break down his barriers. And he was using some nasty kind of language for a four-year-old.
Was he saying, I will kill you? Was
that
one?
He said, you know, kick in the face, and he used a couple of, you know, swear words and things like that. Why do you think he was being violent? Was he being irrational, or do you think there's some other kind of rational reason? I don't really know the answer. I was just interested why you might think he was...
I don't even remember that section. do you think that he was protecting his territory or something? Maybe he wanted to protect his territory, what he was doing, and maybe didn't trust that other people genuinely wanted to help, or that... I don't know.
Do you think maybe it could have just been aggression for aggression's sake? And I'm just wondering how the part of conflict versus peace in your development of your work, are you concentrating more on creating conflict, which, in your words, could be unnecessary, and somehow maybe concentrating more on the peace and the conflict resolution? So, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'll try that. Was that a question?
Sort of.
Is that a suggestion?
Trying to reword it, because I've been sitting on it for a few minutes. So I'm just wondering, when you're telling this man that the violence was unnecessary, and you kind of got lost when trying to describe your own work, I'm wondering whether creating conflict with the audience is necessary, or can you just create a work about peace and resolving conflict within yourself? I don't know. It's sort of a suggestion, sort of a question.
No, it sounds like a suggestion. I'll take
it.
Sorry. Thank you. No, it's true. I mean, I'm questioning why I want to create conflict. It's so arbitrary and so unnecessary. And then I've started to create a series of unnecessary acts just to kind of to do something. And that's kind of how far I've got, which is actually not to create conflict, but just to create a series of unnecessary acts.
I've got something. Just even touching on your question or suggestion. Looking at the element of it that you're interested in, which I feel is... This urge to act on a violent, violent
impulse.
I had a situation where I thought that someone was being very rude to me, and I actually recorded a conversation we had. And in the end, a few days later, I listened to that and found that they were being polite and I was being rude. what you're talking about really struck accord in me in regards to this conflict that we have in ourselves, or the conflict we think people are projecting onto us, and how, I mean, that was an obvious conflict that you went through. But the relationship with you and your real estate agent and all these things, a lot of it we manifest ourselves.
Yeah. But I did escalate this, and I did some, and maybe we'll talk about this kind of parallax view theory, because I asserted my moral judgment on the situation, and I decided that what he was doing was wrong. And I guess there's another perspective on it.
And actually, as we might discuss, or we were discussing earlier, I get to be the theorist who acts like she's never done anything rash or, you know, emotional before at this stage. And I get to say that Nicola was also acting unnecessarily and irrationally and violently when she started yelling at the men. And it was irrational because she knew that he didn't understand him and they weren't speaking the same language. And it was irrational because she started acting violently by yelling and he reacted even more violently by yelling towards her, and neither of them understood each other. So it was completely unnecessary and completely irrational. And she was also violent and unnecessary and irrational in her own behaviour and her own reaction to that. So, you know, it's just kind of a... There has to be other ways to look at a conflict if we want to find, you know, a way of turning it into something constructive.
But it's also interesting, I mean, the way you kind of suggested I, for want of a better word, like humanise this man, trying to look at it, and this, maybe it's the narrative theory?
Narrative therapy
about imagining or exploring other possible narratives of what the situation could be about. And it's kind of, I guess, a narrative from the man's point of view. And you posed a very interesting one that I quite liked, which is, you know, I don't believe, but would you? This is, I mean, it's a you know, in an alternative universe, it is quite possibly the truth. Do you want to? I'd like you to pose this.
Sure. So I was obviously not with Nicola and don't know anything about this man, but the idea of narrative therapy is about moving... It's not just about... It's about reauthoring situations and conflicts to find new alternatives. And it's not just about changing it from a glass is half full to a glass is half empty narrative. It's about saying, okay, so we started off with one story and the conflict looks like this and this is what's brought us to conflict. We've got one story. So we've heard Nicola's story. So let's look for the multi-story. Let's look at all the different ways that we can understand what happened here and find new solutions and new ways of understanding and unattach ourselves as people from that problem. Let's unattach ourselves from the positions that we took in that first story and find new solutions by looking for, you know, a multi-storied way to look at this. So I said to Nicola, yes, your standard of ethics says that you shouldn't throw rocks at ducks. That's, you know, completely appropriate, and that's your, you know, cultural upbringing and your standard of ethics and morality and what you've been taught you should and shouldn't do. What if, let's look at what this man's maybe code of ethics, maybe he thought he was acting ethically. Maybe this man was in a rough patch and he was homeless or unemployed and he had two small children, and ethically he thought, it's wrong to not take care of my children. I have to support them, I have to feed them. And it's wrong to steal, so I have to work. So what I might do is I might collect the duck eggs and sell them in the market so that I can feed my children tonight. And maybe what this man thinks he's doing is trying to scare the duck away so he can take the eggs and sell them in the marketplace, because that seems like a more ethical option for this man than breaking into someone's house and stealing, or not feeding his children, or sending his children out to beg. Maybe that's what this man's code of ethics is telling him is the appropriate way to act. We don't know, but it's kind of a really interesting example that we can use to try and find other stories about what's going on here and try and understand, so what is the man's interest? Maybe there is a way that he doesn't have to throw the rocks at the duck. Maybe there's a way that we can find another solution for this man according to his code of ethics and his interest and his kind of interest in feeding and supporting his family without stealing or committing crimes. And that will also satisfy Nicola's need to not have the duck harmed. So now that we've kind of looked at a different way to understand what's going on and we've tried to analyse what everyone's interests are in this, maybe now we can find another solution that doesn't involve any of the ones that we've already explored. So that's kind of a, you know, way that conflict transformation and, in this case, narrative therapy would look at trying to find other stories to really understand and to separate the people from the problem so that we can find another alternative that we hadn't considered given the original one-storied way of looking at things.
Nicola.
Yeah.
What's the significance of the ghetto blaster?
Oh. sometimes, I guess I work mostly in theatre, and theatres have this tendency to book seasons maybe 2 years in advance. And I was commissioned to make a new show, and I had to come up with a title before I had a show. So as yet, Nat, There is very little significance with a ghetto blaster. I think originally I was interested in making... Before this incident and before I decided to look at peace and conflict or non-violent communication or anything like that, I was interested in obsolescence and irrelevance, and the ghetto blaster was kind of pertaining more to that area of interest, because I have this desperate fear of you know, aging and becoming irrelevant, which is, you know, assuming that I'm relevant. So it's kind of ridiculous.
I was just curious because, like, now hearing you talk about the incident, which yeah. I had read about on Facebook, and hearing like all of these ways to deal with this conflict,
yeah.
and creating a new story or trying to imagine a story from somebody else's point of view and how it got inflamed, like, I guess the symbolic, like, the ghetto blaster seems quite symbolic, like, of the loudness of, like, the way the conflict got so loud, I guess, in such a small amount of time. So, yeah, maybe that's something you can work with. It's a suggestion.
Yeah, yeah, no, excellent. Oh, gosh. More suggestions. Yeah, this is brilliant. Yeah, at the back there.
I really like the idea that you're going for conflict. I think that's a really interesting take on performance art. Like, it's usually never seen. It's usually pushing the boundaries of, like, well, from what I see at my age, which is not much, it's usually pushing endurance and stuff. And I guess this sort of falls in it, but not really, because you're working with the psyche. But, yeah, like, usually with conflict, you usually associate colors with it and noise, which you said. And I don't know, I just think it's a really interesting idea to incorporate the loud noise, which turns into silence, this unbearable silence, mm-hmm. because there's always this sort of dull calm of, like, rage that you have after experiencing conflict, just spouting out ideas there.
Oh, these are much better than my ideas. It's good. I thought I could pretend to be a peace negotiator and imagine that I was using the ghetto blaster as, like, my mobile, portable, I don't know, peace music. I could just go to enemy lines with my ghetto blaster and just, you know, get people dancing. So these are much better ideas. Good.
I am. Would you like to say? Oh, you've been waiting for a while. Go on.
So I was thinking to bring it back to a bit of history of performance art. I guess it follows really well from your question or suggestion. But I was thinking when you were talking about performance and conflict resolution and provoking conflict, right, in the audience, I was thinking about the work of the performance group in the 1970s, who often used that sort of... it was said that there was a story regarding one of their performances where they would always drag up audiences onto the stage and that they would dictate loosely what would happen within a certain framework. And every now and then there would be people that refused, right? So they would not... They refused to participate, and the directors, I suppose, the performance group, refused to continue the performance, right? So this is always described as a sort of a... I'm just wondering if you're familiar with that, first of all. Either of you?
No.
Because I think it's an interesting example of conflict resolution, because what then became the play was them trying to negotiate a different arrangement, right? So that it could continue, because they absolutely have to have audience participation to dictate it. So I was just wondering maybe if you've read that account. It's a pretty weird suggestion, I suppose, but...
Yeah, I don't know quite how to respond. I guess I just want to be careful about the way I use audience participation and kind of be ethical in that way. And I also, it's kind of terrifying to use audience participation. So even though that's kind of what I do, I really didn't want to. Mm. But anyway.
I have one more question.
Yeah.
Yes. I this is a sort of a complicated thought, I guess, but let's see if I can pull it out of my brain. In the film, it seemed that conflict lasted the longest and was more heated and more violent when more people believed the single narrative. In the case where the two kids were playing and the boy, Alexandre, wanted to keep his pile of sticks with electricity and all of that.
And it was diffused quicker.
The girl, and they would have a quick kind of fight and then it was fine again. And actually sort of peace and conflict came in and out of the picture over and over again. But the moment there were several people believing the same narrative and they were kicking the boy on that kind of playground thing, then the more people there were, the more conflict there could be generated, the more people bought into it. And you could say the more singular the narrative, which is he was at fault. And I was wondering if that's not something in performance, if performance art can create multiple narratives, which you're saying might be a way of producing peace or resolving conflict, maybe the way to create the conflict might have a singular narrative and then somehow produce more in order... I mean, I'm not saying this is a... You're just gathering suggestions, right? I was thinking about singularity and multiplicity as two ways you might form an idea in terms of peace and conflict.
Do you want to say something? Yeah, I was just going to say, you've really hit the nail on the head about the more people believing in it as creating kind of longer conflict, because a lot of... Ultimately, the way that we act in the... As I was saying earlier about meanings being such, you know, an important role, everything, all of the meanings that we attribute to things and the way we understand things are informed by our kind of social beliefs and value systems. And those social beliefs and value systems are stronger or exist because millions of people believe in them. And that's why we've learnt them, and that's why they're important and meaningful to us. And that's where the conflict is coming from and articulated. And conflict is often resolved by changing our cultures and by those cultures and beliefs and values adapting to new situations. And that's, it's really about, you know, moving our kind of majority opinion to conform with, you know, a new situation, or going against that, a breach of whatever the status quo might be. Is the whole reason it is a conflict is because there are so many people believing that story.
There's a famous play, I can't remember if it's called The Yellow Shoes, but it's a German play where a man is in a town and somebody gets a pair of yellow shoes, and then suddenly several people have a pair of yellow shoes, and it's a metaphor, and suddenly everybody but he has a pair of yellow shoes, and they're all treating him very differently and he's somehow lesser. And of course the play continues until he's killed. And he's killed because it's always a metaphor for this idea that he doesn't fit in, but it's also he didn't have enough money to get the shoes. He doesn't know where to get the shoes. The shoes are just appearing mysteriously and nobody can really explain why, and they're sort of pretending that they haven't really done anything strange. They're not really conforming with everybody else. And, of course, it's a very big mind, you know, kind of messing up of the mind. But the great thing is that he's killed and everybody's very happy at the end. There's no happy resolution. It's a really good play.
I would like to go back to this man and the duck, if it's possible. I'm really interested from his point of view. Let's see this different scenario for the moment. So man, it's beautiful morning, and I don't know, it was morning? It was morning, probably. I invent my own story from the man and... Okay. The man and the duck and his children perspective. So it's beautiful morning and it's Belgium and it's this wonderful little canal and a few ducks in the canal. And the man is throwing tiny little stones on the duck just to entertain his bored children. And because he's throwing tiny little stones on the duck is moving the small circles and the children are amused by this movement. And everything looks beautiful, peaceful, they're very happy. And out of nowhere arrived this strange woman jogging, and she starts screaming this foreigner language on this peaceful situation. And he got completely threatened, and he protecting the children, even the duck, and screamed back to her, "What about that?" And I really like to hear this blockbuster playing just now. Can you put it on?
The Ghetto Blaster?
Yeah, Ghetto
no,
Blaster.
No, I don't have it.
Oh, but we talked about it.
Yeah, I know, but we don't have it here. Oh. It's in a box.
All right. So anyway, this was my kind of view of the man
and
the duck.
No, this is good. I think you took a very creative approach to the story. The duck... it's time's up. Oh, well. 7 o'clock.
I just want to know how big the stones are.
No, the stones, they're quite significant. They're about, we're going to get cemented. Okay, so they're about like this big. So I guess they're not rocks, but they're enough to hurt a duck. A duck's head is about this big. And the duck was sitting on a nest. So the duck was also protecting its eggs, which I think is quite important to the story. And then I suppose I was trying to protect something that couldn't defend itself. And the fact that the duck was steadfast in protecting her eggs, which I guess really struck me and I found very noble. And so, yeah, but absolutely, it's quite possible that he was doing this to entertain his children, and out comes from the bushes a crazy woman in jogging wear. Hayley did mention that it's quite possible that I was also, it's not quite possible, I was irrational and I was behaving irrationally. Yeah, I don't know.
Can I add something?
I'm not saying that I'm right. Why this story is interesting to me is that it's created this space of dialogue, and it's challenged me to question my moral and ethical position on this and on my actions, because I was very accusatory of his actions, but now I'm actually reflecting and questioning my own actions. And I think that's why I'm interested in this story. I don't think I behaved in a particularly gallant or moral way.
I would add something to that as well. I really enjoyed the story, and I really enjoyed hearing about your thinking process that came out of that encounter. And the fact that this is no longer about the conflict that occurred on the canal, but the conflict that happened in you subsequently. And I've had many situations like that in my life as well. I think probably most of us have. I have like fantasies about keying people's cars all the time, you know. I've similarly been in situations where I've acted on violent impulses. I punched a guy in the face once who was sexually harassing me on a train. And I didn't regret that for a second. And because he fucking deserved it, as far as I was concerned. So I think that in terms of hearing your story, one of the most interesting things that came out of it for me, or one of the boldest statements that you made, was that you enjoyed it. That's one of the most interesting... That's one of the most interesting things for me. Because I think that's very, very honest and very bold. Because I think that there is a part of human nature that absolutely... And I really dislike kind of an unreflective or unreflexive use of a terminology like human nature, but I think there is something in us which is demonstrable and evident that absolutely relishes violence, which is why we keep a space for it in our culture. And moving on from that, I was just going to throw another proposition in there, just like there's been this like constant intonation through this discussion about resolution, and I'm wondering how you might think about violence or the space of violence or aggression if you remove the impulse or the compunction towards resolution. What if you just explore violence as a space in and of itself?
I think it's not resolution, and maybe I say resolution, but I think what I'm maybe thinking about is transformation.
Yeah.
Because I don't think violence is a very constructive action.
No, it's not. So it's completely destructive. That's the thing.
That's the point.
Yeah.
And the other question I was going to ask is I was going to ask if you are familiar with the work of Regina Jose Galindo at all. She makes amazing work about violence. And it is about violence. It's not about resolution. It's about violence. If you can talk about Galindo's work if you like, if you're familiar with it. Maybe it was in your thesis even.
Yeah, a little. I have met Regina a few times and done some workshops with her because I lived in Guatemala for a few years. She's a Guatemalan performance artist. And I think as much as she's not talking about resolution and she is talking about violence, I think there's still something, you know, prescriptive in the way that she talks about violence or the way she uses it that is definitely eliciting a certain response or reaction, or she wants to go somewhere and it's not a violent place with what she's, you know. So I think you can, I mean, it's definitely something you could look at exploring and exploring violence as a kind of way of opening that Pandora's box up so that people flee from it is one way to...
Yeah, that's the thing that I find...
That might activate our space next week.
But that's the thing I find super interesting about her work, actually, is the fact that she goes through it. She doesn't go against it. Yeah. She goes through that space and it revolves back on itself and becomes something else, you know. And I think it also, it's an exercise. It's kind of, she holds up a mirror and it's a very dark mirror. And then that promotes a process of transformation, which is self-driven by the momentum of that violent act, if you know what I'm saying. Like, it pushes it to revolve back on itself, which I think is really interesting.
Cool. Thanks, Sarah-Jane. Yeah. I'm going to look her up.
Mm. And there's something about doing that, and, I mean, she, in some of her works, I mean, she was waterboarded in one of them to kind of talk about torture and things like that, literally went through that process and submits herself to a range of different kinds of violences. And there's a bit of work in some of the works that we were talking about, which I will just kind of make a glib mention to in case anyone wants to look them up. There's Jacques Lacan and Slavoj Žižek, who look at this idea of, I think Lacan calls it the death drive, of when you, the way to actually take away the power from something real is most effectively done by turning that into a symbol. And I think what Regina does is turns that violence into a kind of symbolic field as much as she does submit to the real, and then walks out of it and walks out fine at the end. And she takes away the power from that violence, and turns that violence into ultimately powerless because she can walk out from that.
She does. One of the things that's most interesting about that waterboarding work, because I heard her speak about that recently, and she walked away from it okay, but the perpetrator didn't. He was completely fucked up. Which is what I mean by it revolves back on itself. You know, that's what one of the things that's super interesting about that work, I think.
I'm so sorry to jump in right now, but we are at time. And thank you so much, everybody, for coming to hear Nicola and Hayley speak and to see the film. I'm so sorry to cut you off, but we have a time limit in the building. thank you so much to both of you and for screening the film. Thank you all for coming. Tomorrow we'll have Sarah Rodigari, I believe, in Evenings in Residence, which will also be wonderful. So please do come again at 5. And again, thank you so much for coming. And I'll turn the lights up so you can see your way out. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.